Hey everybody, it's ShadowBlizzard3000 here, and just as promised, after my Fruits Basket quick first impressions there, I have a whole host of spring shows to talk about this time, and already spring is at least shaping up to be much better than winter was for me, because I have a lot of good shows that I'm really getting into and looking forward to watching here. So why don't we just go ahead and we'll go down the list and I'll talk about what's on my watch list. And of course, if anything else comes into the fray later, I'll of course get into it. But until then, let's just get started. All right, so first off, we have the standard, I don't know if you call it standard, but we have the traditional sports drama or dramedy or whatever of the season, and that is of course starting with Cinderella Nine. Of course, this one is by TMS Entertainment, also the ones doing Fruits Basket, but you know, they can make good shows. Of course, this is actually based on a mobile game, but as far as I can tell, the stories are pretty much nothing in common. I mean, the mobile game, you are the player character and you're like some unseen baseball star with an injury putting together a girls team. Nothing like that here. This is a bit more Taisho Baseball Girls, where you get one character who wants to play baseball, trying to gather up her classmates to play baseball with her. Not exactly alike, I'm just saying Taisho Baseball Girls is probably the best comparison that you're gonna see with this, because they're very similar in that. And for the first episode, it's kind of your usual, it's kind of your typical, let's introduce the characters, let's introduce the game. But I like this. They don't dump a bunch of information on you. They don't tell you all the fundamentals of baseball in this first episode. I'm sure we'll get some more explanation a little later for those who don't play the game. But other than that, it is a bit of a standard first episode, but it's charming. And I like a lot of the characters, at least the few that we've been introduced to. It doesn't just throw everybody out the gate here. It actually looks like it's going to gradually introduce you to the characters. I mean, you have our main character, you have Tsubasa, Arihara. I always want to say Aihara, but it's Arihara. She's the one who's kind of being the proactive one, trying to put together the team. And we get introduced to Tomoe, her childhood friend. Yay, childhood friends. You get another one, Nozaki Yuki, who apparently, I guess, played sports in her time, but I don't know, quit for some reason. She played basketball first. And we get introduced to little girl wearing a hoodie. She's not little, she's just short in stature. But of course, guess what, guys? We got the evil student council afoot. Dun dun dun. Uh-oh, it's the production committee. Because it looks like the student council is going to be obtrusive and in the way all the time. So maybe we'll get a little anime gutteries in this. And you guys all thought that was bad? Come on. Of course the student council's evil. It's a cliche of anime. So I'm looking forward to this one. Looks like it'll be a fun baseball show. Glad it's not trying too hard to follow the smartphone game. It's trying to do its own thing. Even if it's been done a little bit before, it still looks to be like a nice, fun show. Definitely gonna give this a one to watch. Okay, continuing on with our list of comedies. Now this one we have Hitoriboshi's Lifestyle, as it's literally translated as, though Crunchyroll just uses the full Japanese title. Alright, so this is your kind of typical cute girls do cute things. In this case, you have a girl named Bochi. That's actually her first name. Hitori is her family name. The problem is, she's extremely shy. She's starting up middle school. God, that is the worst time when you are really shy. Trust me, I know. And of course, her childhood friend is going to a different school. And believe me, this is all shit I remember very vividly from my first year of 7th grade. Oh, it sucked. Her childhood friend decided randomly to put this weird condition on her. She can't be friends with her until she makes friends with everybody in class. I don't know why. Maybe she's thinking she's being helpful by helping Bochi by coming out of her shell, but trust me, if you want to deal with shy people, the best way to bring them out of their shell is to be gentle. You trying to forcefully coax us out just only ends in disaster. This is another one I'm thinking is going to be a great fun show this season. I can definitely relate to the main character. It's another case of a really shy person, something I relate to all too well. It's got a lot of great little jokes, a lot of great gags. One of my favorite bit has to be the moment we sort of meet her. She has like this little strategy guide for that she made for herself on how to make friends, and it's nothing like you'd expect. It's not like be approachable or whatever. No, her first plan of attack is to abolish middle school. Well, that's not gonna work, obviously, so that was already failed out the gate. Second plan, second strategy, second plan was to get into a class with no classmates. And this one, she actually has somewhat of a fighting chance, not really, but she actually tries to make an effort by putting up a notice on the school door while the entrance ceremony is still going on. She goes and puts a little notice on the classroom door saying, "Class one has been abolished. Please go to another class." And she's like, "Well, if I don't have any classmates, I don't have to make new friends," or something like that. Or it's like, "I made all new friends with zero people." Ha ha. That loophole, of course, doesn't work, though people found it funny. Then she comes across the girl who sits in front of her. Her name is Naoko. She seems to be a little quiet, always on her phone. And it doesn't go what quite very doesn't go quite well when they first meet, because she's very tense and very nervous and she vomits. And the whole show's just her really trying to be approachable with Naoko. And it's actually really funny and really cute. Another great little joke is Bocchi actually like falls on the ground and it like conjures up a cloud of dust and actually makes Naoko cough. So it's like, wow, they actually acknowledge the environment around them when characters do weird stuff. Or how she writes like notes on her hand. It's like, and she has like question and planned response. And, but of course, she asks like Naoko, "Hey Naoko, you're always on your phone. What are you doing?" And Naoko replies, "Gaming." She's like, "Oh shoot, I didn't make notes for gaming." Okay, so Hitori Bocchi, another solid show this season. Really looking forward to it. Another good show to get some laughs out of. Okay, now let's get on to the one that's really getting a lot of attention and a lot of praise already. We'll see if I'm quite there. That is Kimetsu no Yaiba, or Demon Slayer, Kimetsu no Yaiba. Don't quite get the redundancy in the titling there, but whatever. Whatever, Aniplex. All right, so this is a bit of a historical piece, and I like me a good historical piece. It's not really a historical piece, it's historical fiction. But I like shows that tend to be set. I like period pieces, I guess. It doesn't even matter if they're fictional or real life. I like shows that are set against a period. And even better, this is actually set in the Taisho period, which is like the early mid 20th century, so like the 1912s through the 1920s. I'm not sure exactly what period it's set. Well, I'm not sure exactly what year it's set in. It's just set in some unspecified time in the Taisho era, which I was a little surprised about. Yeah, I didn't really exactly read the plot summary carefully. I never do anymore because they always trick me. And of course, this is probably a bit of a surprise for anybody who knows me, because this is a shonen manga. A shonen manga. Yeah, I'm watching an anime that's based on a shonen manga. You probably know, because I'm sure a lot of people have watched this, especially if you are watching this video. This is, of course, a story about a boy, isn't he? His name is Tanjiro. He lives with his family up in the mountains, but then, of course, in typical RPG tropey fashion, his whole family is slaughtered. No, my beloved peaceful village. With the one exception, his sister, Nezuko, manages to survive. However, she unfortunately has been turned into a demon as a result. Although the show kind of hints that she has demon blood in her already, like maybe she was a cursed child. No spoilers, please. No, I'm sure it's explained later, but no spoilers. Just no spoilers, please. I'm interested in where it goes here. Although she does kind of start off aggressively towards him, at some point another like a demon hunter named Giyu shows up, and of course he wants to naturally kill Nezuko, but Tanjiro doesn't want his sister killed. He tries to protect her, and then she turns and protects him, which is really nice. All right, so this is a show by UFO Table, or is it Ufotable? I don't know. Somebody tell me how the studio's name is supposed to be said. Is it UFO Table or Ufotable or Ufotable? I don't know. But you could if you know the staff, you could probably guess why I watched this, even though it's a Shonen Jump show. All right. I know this show's getting a ton of praise, and I can honestly agree with a lot of it. It's not like I absolutely hate this first episode or that I'm even on the fence about it. I am really intrigued. However, it does have some of the trappings of these types of shows that always tend to bug me, and which is why I generally don't like to watch them a lot. And it's like, the only way I can describe them is like, oh yeah, it's got the shonen cliche trappings. But the fact of the, but I shouldn't say that because I know shonen manga is not a genre, it's a demographic. It just means manga aimed at boys. There's a lot of manga that are classified as shonen that you wouldn't think of it. But yet, why do so many shonen seem to feel so alike? Why do they all seem to have the same plot conventions? I don't know. But let me start with the I'll start with the positives. Of course, the animation is great. It looks beautiful. I love UFO Table. I'll just call them that for a while. I love their animation style. They always have really pretty looking animation. I can't deny that. But their shows, to me, have always been really hit and miss. Besides the pretty visuals, I'm intrigued enough by the story. I like the whole based around demons, even though the demons seem to be kind of vampire-ish. We'll see. I'm just curious what really happens. And of course, the music's awesome. I love the vocal tracks. I really like a lot of the instrumentations. I think the string section actually sounds really full and filling for a change. But all that in good time. I would love to actually hear the full soundtrack properly, but that will probably be a little while. So let me get into the one aspect about this that's making me weary about the show going forward. And that is, of course, during the battle sequence, which is impressively animated, but it has the same stupid problem that shows like these always have. That is, there's too much damn dialogue and exposition during the fucking action scenes. Why do so many shows do this? It's whether it be Rurouni Kenshin, whether it be Yu-Gi-Oh, whether it be Bleach. It's like, just show me the action. Don't talk during it. I'm not saying there can't be dialogue snippets or anything. They don't need to be totally silent. But and I'm not talking about like, okay, characters shout or exclaim or say, no, don't do this, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I'm talking about when like they have to explain the action to me. Like, I can't just see what happened. And this is especially obvious when Tanjiro counters an attack by Giyu by tossing a rock at pretty heavy force. And of course, Giyu can block that no problem. But then Tanjiro's hatchet actually comes flying and he actually is caught off guard by that and he narrowly misses him. Awesome action scene. Then they have to explain it to me, like I didn't see what just happened. Okay, well, they explain the mechanics of it, but he also recounts. It's like, again, I don't know why so many shonen action shows do this. They always feel this bizarre need to give you the play-by-play after it's happened. And it's like, I don't need to see your strategy. I don't care what the other character did to you. It's just, show me the action, that's all. I don't know why shows always do this, and that's what I'm worried about the show going forward. As good as the story can be, I don't need the play-by-play for the action scenes, okay? I don't need you to explain everything. Another sort of minor gripe is mostly in the main character. I'm worried he's going to be kind of bland as Wonder Bread here, just only for the fact that, oh yeah, everybody in the village loves him and he's like perfect and everything. Now, granted, this could change because now that his family's gone, he has no reason to really stick around his village probably, and he's going to move on with his sister in tow to try and find a cure for her. That's not a problem. It's just more like, okay, yeah, he's the perfect main character. Everybody loves him. Everybody depends on him. He can do no wrong. He can't do anything bad. Right, he already has super strength or whatever. Actually, he has an enhanced sense of smell, but it's not like I need the characters to be gritty and bad and angry all the time. Right? I'm just saying the characters need to be flawed. You can have a morally straight character and still make him flawed. But again, this is the first episode, and again, no spoilers, please. This is the first episode. There's still more to come, and I'm looking forward to it. My gripes aside, I'm still looking forward to watching the show. I think it's gonna be a pretty solid show this season. It might end up being the one show that everybody loves, and I'm just like kind of lukewarm on, or at least moderately enjoy. But we'll see. We'll see. Okay, guys, that's really gonna wrap it up for this quick first round of springtime impressions. So thanks for joining me on this one. Looking forward to seeing what all these shows have to bring. Glad this season is shaping up to be a lot more interesting than the last one.